Hey, good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to the first ever PegaWorld Inspire Live Builds. Well, guys, come on. Okay, we haven't even started yet. I'm sorry. Anyway, I hope everyone is comfortable in their business casual pajamas. I'm your host, Justin McCahill, from the Innovation and Experience team at Pega, and I'm so excited to bring you the next hour of interactive content. However, I'm not too happy about wearing a buttoned-up shirt for the first time in months, but I will survive. We have three live builds for you today, with each presentation running about 15 minutes. If you have any questions or comments, drop them into the chat box and we'll get to them as quickly as we can. Our first presentation will be all about building apps in low code, starting in just a moment. This session will be presented by Sam Trumlett, Senior Product Architect at Pega. Sam will be talking about how Pega's low code app studio boosts productivity by enabling business and IT organizations to build apps quickly and collaboratively without ever writing a single line of code. At 10:25, we are lucky to have the amazing Mehran Barak, Director of Product and Engineering, Data Integrations. This session will demonstrate how crucial system integration is to your enterprise applications and beyond. Mehran will also be diving into Pega's new data virtualization and platform integration capabilities mentioned earlier in Alan's keynote. Our final live build will be at 10:45 with Sean Wardis, Senior Director of Product Design. Sean will be demonstrating how Pega's UX interaction library delivers innovative, high-efficiency production apps that your employees will not only be able to use, but will actually love. And if we finish early, I'm going to share some of my band's exciting new house music that we've been working on in quarantine. Oh, sorry, this is embarrassing. One second. Hello? None. Turn it all on. Okay. Okay, so actually no music at all, ever again, but instead join Karim and Stephanie for the Roadmap Tech Talk at 11. All right, with all that out of the way, let's learn about low-code at Pega. I'd like to introduce the one and only Sam Trumlett. How are you doing today, Sam?
Good. How are you doing, Justin?
Oh, I'm so good. Excited to be here. I'm glad to hear you're doing well. I heard that you know a thing or two about Pega's low-code offering. Is that true?
It is, yeah, and I'm excited to talk about it today. I think it's a term that we hear all over the industry now. Everyone has kind of their own definitions of it, so I'm excited to talk about what low-code means to me and show you some of the tools that Pega has in order to enable all of you.
Hey, thank you so much. Just to remind everybody, go ahead and ask questions, and Sam, take it away.
Thanks. So like Justin mentioned, I'm Sam Trumlett. I'm a Senior Product Architect here at Pega, and I'm going to talk to you about low-code. And before we get into that really quick, I just want to say the reason it's becoming such an important issue is a stat that really jumps out to me, which is 42% of developers' time is spent maintaining legacy code. And that equates to about $300 billion annually. So there's a huge investment going into old legacy systems using old coding methods. So we really, as an organization, need to become more and more productive. And that's what low code means to me, is how, as an organization, can we become more productive? So I'm going to hop right into my demo here to make sure that I can show you guys as much as possible. So what you're seeing here is the city of Metropolis, and they've implemented an app factory. For those who don't know what App Factory is, last year at PegaWorld, we announced it. An App Factory is an application for managing and governing citizen development programs. So similar to, you know, the time spent maintaining old legacy code, we also see a trend where organizations are looking to broaden who is doing the application development. So 2% of the world's population knows how to code. So if we're just using that really, really small sliver to try to produce results and become more productive, we're working with a really small portion of the population. And I think everyone feels that. You know, we go to IT, they're already really, have a long backlog working on strategic technical projects. So some of these smaller, you know, equally as important, but, you know, lower priority applications get kind of pushed to the bottom. So a lot of organizations are starting to do citizen development where they can open up a whole new breadth of, you know, non-traditional technical developers in order to help them deliver outcomes. And that's where we started to see the trend in citizen developer grow. And that's why we created App Factory, to help manage and govern those applications that will help complement the larger enterprise applications that you probably already have within your organization.
Hey, Sam, actually, real quick, mind if I jump in?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I had a big question about IT's involvement in this. And I love IT. Please don't turn off the stream, please. But I was curious if with citizen development, does that mean no IT or some IT? Or how do you view that?
Yeah, so I actually come from an IT background. I worked in IT before coming over to engineering here. And I think there's a common misconception that low code or no code means no IT. And really, we couldn't feel that's farther from the truth. In fact, where we see the most successful results, especially in large enterprises, is when we have a collaboration between IT and the business in order for them both drive to make the whole organization more productive. And that's really critical, especially in large organizations where you need both. You need the enterprise standards that IT provides and the agility that you're looking for with citizen development.
Oh, thank you very much. Appreciate that.
Yeah, no problem. So without further ado, let's start taking a look at something. So I would love to talk App Factory with you guys all day, but unfortunately, we don't have time for that. So what I'm just doing is show you here, we have the city of Metropolis. They've implemented an App Factory. You can see a bunch of the different applications they have. For us today, we're going to hop into Vehicle Manager. Now, this application is where the city of Metropolis uses to manage all of their vehicle purchases and other things like vehicle registration, managing vehicles. You know, let's say a fire department needs a new truck, or, you know, sanitation needs a new vehicle, something like that. They come here to do that. So we're going to go into App Studio, and App Studio is the tool to build applications in Pega. And it's really the fastest way to build applications. And I'm going to show you some of the enhancements we've made that, again, allow you to be more productive so you can spend your time focusing on more strategic things. So back in January, we announced the new Pega Express methodology. And it really breaks down into three pillars. And Alan briefly mentioned this in his keynote. But the first is personas and the channels that they're interacting with the app through. We can see that here on the application overview page. Next is case types or the micro journeys within this application. And finally is the data objects that are part of this case type or micro journey, you know, that will either be collecting or other systems that we are connecting to. And this is a really fast way to help you not only jumpstart your application, but have some clarity on what it is of the outcomes that you're trying to drive towards. So this is all brand new, and there's a lot of stuff that's been built into App Studio to help accelerate development. And there's a bunch of great videos and articles on Pega.com and as part of PegaWorld. So be sure to check all of those out. Now, before we start looking at case design, which is always the core of most Pega applications, I just want to hop real quick and preview the application. So I think one of the great things about Pega is that we really get a jump start when we create an application. A lot's already been done for us. And here we're looking at a user portal. I could go into some of the authoring, but I think Justin mentioned at a later session, Sean Wardis will be showing you how you build really fantastic UI and user experiences in Pega. And so you notice that this particular application is using our new Cosmos design framework. So definitely be sure to check out Sean's session later today. So let's start hopping into case type. So those familiar with Pega know that case types are really at the core. Case manager is really at the core of everything that we do in Pega. And it's really critical in order for us to be able to build out those micro journeys that we're looking for. So we're going to hop right into vehicle purchase. And here we can see the case lifecycle. Now, cases are broken down into stages, which are the major milestones that go through that a case goes through. And here for the vehicle purchase or purchasing a new vehicle, we see we have requests, we have acquisition, we have delivery, and we have fulfillment. So those are the major milestones that this particular microjourney is going to go through. Then within each stage, we have what we call steps. And there's really two main types of steps, which are human interaction steps, such as initial requests, where we're kind of have like an intake form or capturing that data that we talked about that's a part of this case. And then we also have what we call automations. And I'll go into more depth in them in just a minute, but automations are basically steps that don't require human interaction. Things like sending out notifications, attaching documents, anything that, you know, we wouldn't need a human to interact with. So when I click on a step here, let's look at what the authoring is like. And again, you'll notice that you're not seeing code anywhere in this demo. Really, we're just focusing on getting to our outcomes as quickly as possible using really easy to use curated experiences. So first I can see I can control things like, you know, what's the routing options here. I could even define some SLAs like a goal and deadline, do something like if I pass my goal or deadline, escalate to my manager or send an email, all those kind of things. But let's look at configure view. And this is really how we start to capture information into this case. So I can provide some things like a view name. I could select a template. Again, Sean will go into more depth in this later, but we have a bunch of different section templates that allow you to organize your information in a way that makes sense. And you can even add to those. So if your organization has a new branded template or a specific layout that you want to use, you can create that and expose it up into App Studio to allow all of your App Studio users to use. And so let's take a look at what it looks like to start authoring some experience here. So I could click add, I could add a new field here or create a new field if it doesn't exist yet on this case. And I can also start to edit the UI using really easy to use, you know, drag and drop tools. I can use move estimated cost above year, right? Really easy to do. And again, all without having to write code, so we can get to our results really, really quickly. And so this is a fairly simple case type, but let's hop into vehicle registration, which might be a slightly more advanced case type. So I'm gonna hop in here. And so here we can see, you know, again, we have our stages and steps, and we have a bunch of different automations here. So again, we have a step which, you know, human interaction, we're capturing the intake form for the vehicle registration. And you see we have some routing like we did last time. But let's look at one of the automations we have here, which is a notify. So you can see I can author out some of the different, like who this is going to based on participants. I could also select, you know, different fields that I'm capturing as part of my case or email addresses. And then I can also go into the message and I can compose this message, you know, give it a subject as well. And I can use information that I'm capturing on the case. So this really allows me to create dynamic content that I can send out, again, without having to write code. I can take the information I'm getting on the case and distribute it back out if I need to.
Actually, Sam, I had a question. One more. Yeah. Sorry to interrupt. I was curious, actually. I saw the notifications there. Is it just email or do you have SMS or carrier pigeon? Anything else?
No carrier pigeon yet. But we do have, recently we've improved the notification automation. It's actually one of the newer things we've released where we can go across a variety of different channels. So it's not just sending emails, although we do have a send email automation, like you can see here in fulfillment and approval rejection. But it also will send things like mobile push notifications. In fact, if we go back to preview application, you also see that you get in-app notifications. So if I look at these, I can see Sean has liked my post and comment. He's also noticed me, commented to me in a Ferrari, hopefully that I will be getting that for a birthday gift. So it's not just one channel. You can really push notifications across a variety of different channels to make sure users know what's going on within the app.
All right. Thank you. Appreciate that.
No problem. So let's hop into another automation. Here we're generating a document. So you can imagine that, you know, as a vehicle gets registered, we also want to, you know, get the little registration document that's required as part of this. So again, we can select a view and this view can be built and authored based on the view editing we saw in the vehicle purchase case where, you know, we can select a template, easily drag and drop fields into that template and then attach that based on the view we select here in this configuration. But let's get to adding a new automation here. So again, we click on adding a step. We could add in collect information or approve reject, which we see a lot in the review registration, which I'll go over in just a minute. Or we could do a multi-step form, which is basically a collection of collect informations that we want to do back to back. But instead, let's go into more and let's look at the different automations that we have. So you can see we can attach content, change the stage, all this good stuff. Similar to templates, you can add to this list. So you might have a common integration or process that your organization is using. And again, you can build that and make it accessible in App Studio in order to ensure that everyone's using kind of a single source of truth if you have, let's say, a common like budget approval process in your organization.
Hey, Sam, actually, I got a question from Stella M. She asked if you can send notifications to the vehicle HMI as a channel.
Yeah, definitely. So I'll show channels in authoring if I have a moment at the very end of this. But yeah, you can basically choose the channel in which you want to push that notification to and allow that to come in. So very flexible as far as sending notifications.
Oh, and actually, we got another one coming in too from I'm not going to pronounce your name correctly, but Shrikanth N. She asked, can we populate document name dynamically on Generate PDF?
Yeah, you can. So as opposed to here, I just have registration request. I could also go into here and sorry, I just added in a new automation, but I could also go into here and reference, maybe vehicle name or something like that. Right. So you could definitely have dynamic names as well, rather than just kind of hard coded strings like I have here.
Excellent. Thank you.
Yeah. So I added I decided the automation we're going to add is post to pulse. So, you know, obviously I can choose the user posting and I can also create a message here. I'm just going to do a simple one here and say, I love this app. Now, before we see this change, getting implemented in the case. I'll run the case in just a moment. One thing I also want to point out is review registration. So we saw the approval shapes being one of the steps we could add earlier. And you'll notice here we have a couple of them and then this fun looking orange shape. So if I click the process icon in the bottom right, you can see here that it's not just about defining linear shapes. If I need to do something like, you know, go to several levels of approval and have it fork based on, let's say, information I'm capturing within the case, I can create decision shapes and put those into my process. And I'll do that authoring within App Studio. Again, trying to accelerate your time to outcome so that you're not spent, you know, having to go back and forth to do things that maybe will take a really long time. And you'll notice that I can also open this process in Dev Studio. So I think there's a common misconception that you can't, you know, do work in App Studio, then go to Dev Studio, and then you can't go back and forth. And really they're meant to be used in synchronization with each other. App Studio is the fastest way to build a lot of features. And actually right after my session, Mayron Barak will be showing how to do data and integrations using tools like App Studio. And you'll notice if you watch her demo that she's gonna build out an integration. And if you were to try to do that in Dev Studio, you'd have to build classes, you'd have to build properties, data pages, connectors, authentication, all of that has been wrapped up in a curated experience in App Studio so that what would normally take you an hour or two can take you 5 minutes.
Hey, Sam, I'm sorry to interrupt you there. I know you have so much more to say, but actually we're already up against time. We're like 30 seconds left. Do you have anything else you want to say real quick?
Yeah, so let's just save and run this case real quick just so we can see our new automation. And definitely check out the other sessions that are coming after mine. They'll go into much more depth than I was able to. So let's just quickly fill out our make and model here. So there's actually a outbreak of extremely fast squirrels and in Metropolis. So we are going to buy a Lamborghini for the Parks Department to chase them down. And just in case anyone looks at the bill, I'm going to put Dennis here as the purchaser.
Typical Dennis.
Yep. And then we'll just fill out the rest of this information. And when we submit, we'll see that our new automation for posting to Pulse and our message of I love this app has been fired. Again, all without having to, there we go, all without having to ever write a line of code or do anything. So really powerful tool in App Studio. It's impossible to show you all the features in 15 minutes. But one other thing I just want to stress is if we go to channels and interfaces, I know there's a question about it earlier. I'm sorry we weren't able to get to that during this demo, but you can build those really powerful experiences, things like a chatbot that you're seeing here in App Studio as well. App Studio is not a broken down version of the Pega platform. You still have all that power and really all that runway at your fingertips. So there's a whole bunch you can do in App Studio. Definitely check out the other sessions with Mayron and Sean that will go into more depth. And check out all the awesome content we have, not only at PegaWorld, but on Pega Community and Pega.com.
Wow. Okay, Sam, thank you so much. You sped run that. I really appreciate the help. And so I just want to say thank you so much, Sam, for that great demo. Please join our next session on data and integration starting in a few minutes. We'll see you then.
Thank you.